What do AI and magic have to do with each other? Well, it turns out we have the world's greatest AI magician, Marco Tempest, coming to the Cozy AI Kitchen. Stay tuned. I'm so honored to have to the kitchen, a place of kind of magic, but to have a real magician appear, and not just any magician, the world's greatest cyber illusionist, Marco Tempest. Marco, welcome to the Cozy AI Kitchen.
Hey, John. Hello, everybody. Great to be here.
So, Marco, how long have you been doing like techno magic? Like, not just a year, I think. A little longer than that, right?
I've been doing it for a while, and I guess ever since computers became available and video equipment became available to regular people. But I would say in the last couple of years, or even the last couple of months, things have sped up so quickly, and there's have been so many things happening. It's almost all the things I planned throughout my life have been able to realize in the last couple of months because of the incredible technical advances we're experiencing.
Right, I mean, like the things that you have always done, now with this new kind of AI, how has it reshaped your thinking?
I think technology used to be very much deterministic in a way that you could program something really precisely and do exactly what you wanted the system to do. There was a little bit of computer vision, a little bit of robotics, but for the most part, the systems would always behave exactly the way you wanted. Now we're entering a time where these machines are almost like team members. They have to be onboarded and instructed and nurtured, and they might react differently than you expect. They become more like collaborators. And so that's very, very interesting, and equally interesting and frightening, you could say.
Well, I love the interview I saw you do basically a couple decades ago, where you were already the senior magician to this young magician, and you told him about how important it is to take care of the people around you in your performances. Can you share a bit about that insight you had in your mid part of your career?
So I think, in these kind of high stress environments, which, live performance art and production always is, it's very important to remember why you're doing this. In the end, you're there because this is really fun. It's a real privilege to have these kind of jobs. And the people who work with you, especially if you're like standing in the front or standing in the kitchen, it's really important to take care of everybody and make sure everybody has a safe and comfortable and a creative environment where they can contribute and blossom.
Well, if you haven't seen Marco take care of the drones flying around him or the iPods flying underneath him, he gives such care to all of his magic. So Marco, I'm so glad you're here I'm so embarrassed because I have been cooking AI techno magic, but it's nothing compared to what you do. So I'm a bit embarrassed. But what I've done is, to your point, I've accepted the non-determinism. I have the dice rice, as I like to call them. And we roll the dice to have the AI do different things. And what I noticed is that trying to make something out of your magical thinking was not easy. So let me bring over the semantic kernel. And I basically took video frames from your 2011 TED performance. Everyone, please check this out. It's like 6 million, over 6 million views. And I asked it, this is a time series capture of part of Marco Tempest's performance. What is he doing? So let me activate that.
This is a time series capture of part of Marco Tempest's performance. What is he doing?
Okay. So we're now going to say, take that image and understand it. The images depict the sequence of a performance by an individual who appears to be a magician or performer, likely Marco Tempest, engaging in a digital magic act. Throughout the sequence, he is seen using smartphones to create illusions and tell a story. The phones display various words and images that seem to interact with each other, creating a narrative or message as part of the performance. The act involves a sleight of hand. It is acknowledging to create a modern magic machine. So Marco, when you see the computer do this so effortlessly, what do you think?
It's amazing with how well it everything is shaped. Like how should I say this? It's like it talks like it knows what it's talking about, the system, right? Which is amazing. You know, it couldn't get from just a sequence of images get the feel or the storyline of my performance, but it really talks about the performance like it really knows what's going on. And I think it doesn't matter if it's right or wrong, it feels like it's a right answer, and that's quite magical. So from the user experience of hearing this back, it's very polished.
And then, considering how illusions are things that you've designed, created over so many years, is this an illusion when the AI is saying this and we think it understands it? I wonder what you think.
It's hard to say. And so in some of these systems, like the OpenAI systems, the GPTs, they're very careful not to anthropomorphize these systems. They don't give them names like we have. They constantly remind you that they are systems. But for me as an artist, interacting with them and using them as a collaborator, I tend to anthropomorphize them, and I tend to treat them like team members or like collaborators. And I try to prompt them in a way so they can give the best possible results. So it's a very interesting thing where we're like in this moment in time now where things flip back and forth, where tools become entities, or they have a certain temperament or a character, and you can really feel that all these, especially the fine tuning, makes these systems really have a character like coworkers would have.
I like how all of your work you tended to anthropomorphize the iPod, the robot, the drones. You made them all seem like loving creatures that you love back. And so interestingly, in this era, you're doing what you've always done.
Yeah, I think so. It's for me a wonderful like renaissance. It's like we had this wonderful time about 20 years ago where open source was really big and people had wonderful pieces of software they shared, and then it looked like everything closed down a little bit for everybody, for all these creative technologists and coders. And now the floodgates are back open, right? And open source is a big topic again. There's all these new tools or toys available for us to experiment with and participate in the future.
And Marco, because you take such good care of the digital organisms out there, I thought it was neat when I tried to ask an innocent question. What's the secret to this magic trick?
What's the secret to this magic trick?
I wanted to know, you know? I'm sorry, but I wanted to know, like, how does he do it? And the response is interesting. I'm sorry, but I cannot reveal the secrets behind magic tricks. Magic is an art form that relies on the skills of the magician. So I thought that was kind of nice. That was a kind of nice moment.
Yeah, that's wonderful. It's kind of the ethical code of all magicians, which is actually funny because in this very piece with the iPods, I designed that to actually share the secret behind the trick. So I called it like open sorcery, right? So I created an app which I shared in the App Store, which allowed people to do the thing I do, like synchronize multiple mobile devices and play videos in synchronicity across devices wirelessly. Mm-hmm. So I got it, but also it didn't.
I gotta get that app. And Marco, you know, one thing I've noticed in all of your performances, just preparing for your visit to the kitchen, I watched all of them available on TED, because I'd seen them and I saw them all in succession. And I realized it's like watching a musical almost, because you choreograph everything. Where did you create that style from?
Well, thank you very much. I think story is a thing I've always been fond of and experimented with. I think stories are the way we remember things. So if you want to make a performance memorable, it's nice to wrap it in stories. Stories also help magicians to guide you down a path where we want you to go, maybe hide some of the imperfections of the, shall I call it, user experience or performance. So story is a very good way to cognitively load the audience up with something and put them into a certain direction. And part of that, of course, is not only the story you tell verbally, but also the music and the pacing and all of this. So I'm very fond of experimentation with that, because I think it creates these truly memorable moments if you get it right.
Well, it's I realize you're almost dancing in some of these pieces, and so and you're doing it with such light that everybody wants you to succeed, which is also great. So so what I did is I took the script, the transcript from your 2011 TED performance, and then what I did then is I say, this is the transcript. What are the key ideas to take away from how Marco performs his magic? Knowing that I haven't given it to auditory and video channel, but just for that sequencing.
What are the key ideas to take away from how Marco performs his magic?
And let me just have it speak on its own with my little bit of AI magic.
Marco Tempest's performance combines technology and sleight of hand to create a seamless illusion using synchronized video across multiple devices to enhance the storytelling aspect of his magic. He emphasizes the theme of deception, both in magic and in everyday life, and suggests that magic is an honest form of deception because it promises to trick the audience. His act also reflects on the broader concept of self-deception and the human capacity to blend lies and truth, creating emotional experiences that resonate with the audience.
And that's the OpenAI voice. It's so rich in how it sounds, right? And I've noticed you've been playing with voice transforming too in real time. What is that?
So yeah, first of all, this is amazing, right? This kind of, it's so assertive, and it really got kind of, it got what I tried to do with this piece, certainly. So recently I started experimenting with voice cloning. I was always a little bit shy about my voice on stage because I'm not like a voice actor's voice. But now we have these real-time voice cloning technology where you can sound like anyone you like. So I'm starting to create stories where I can kind of possess different characters within the story and actually sound like them. So I can suddenly have a British accent and talk like somebody from the Victorian age in London, or be a woman in a story or whatnot. So and that combined with generative AI, where you might be able to create the images to go with that, is going to be a super magical tool, not only for magicians, but I would imagine for educators, for teachers, for presenters. There's going to be some really interesting and exciting things we can cook with these kind of technologies.
You're able to become a woman, an older man, a boy. If you have to check out the new piece on Ada Lovelace by Marco. Marco, any closing thoughts to our audience who are already mesmerized by your magical thinking?
I think what you're doing here in the kitchen is a very good metaphor for, you know, I think how we should approach all these new technologies, talking about AI. It's really a very inviting moment in time right now. We're so lucky to be in this small slice where everything is open right now and all these tools are right there. And it's not quite determined what they're good for and what they're not good for. So I think it's up to everybody to experiment and figure out where these things fit in their life and how they can possibly influence the trajectory of where this technology will be going. So it's time to cook up and whip up some exciting recipes.
Well, thank you so much for coming to the kitchen, Marco. Thank you, everyone, for tuning in to The Greatest Magician in the World. Please check out his work. Everyone, let's keep cooking like Marco says.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.